Chapter 6 is a lot more fun, dealing with the purpose of education and the culture of schools and even the different choices you could have in schools and how that's changed. And then just the different levels between preschool and elementary and middle school, high school. And so it's laid out pretty nice. And there's still some controversy in it, of course, because not everybody agrees what is the purpose. And we've talked about that a number of times so far in the course. Well, it comes a little bit more open today on what is the purpose of education and what should be the core values of the school and stuff. So I'm going to ask you to carry a little more load. It's still got kind of long, but it's a lot easier and stuff that you can relate to, stuff that you'll handle, stuff that you'll know. So what is the place of schools in society? Long-held traditions that come with it. First, and this you would have known without any prompting here at all, basic skills of literacy and computation. This gets a little more murky here. Society's ideals, social efficiency and social mobility. So let's go back to the textbook. Look at this. Started out, as you know, from past study. Private schools and academies established in colonial times for children who had the means to pay. Then later on, you know, it became more, public education came into being for what's known here that highlights commoners. And then, you know, early on, what was the focus of school education and schooling? Obviously, it was to read the Bible and develop high morals, become good citizens. But ultimately, to learn to read was a big thing, so you could read the Bible. And of course, it's devolved into many, many different things today. And down here they highlight, this author highlights this, primary support democratic equality, which is a real mushy thing, social efficiency and social mobility. And so we have this over here. And what's interesting is they drop this social equality or democratic equality. So I want you to put this in here. This will be number one here, and with a little definition right here. Democratic That's number one. And then social efficiency of schools is to prepare students for their role in society. And then move an individual to up, this would be you, up or down in the social class. And I'm not sure you know what that is. Social class by income is part of that. And this last statement down here, school boards, educators, parents, and communities have their own beliefs. Interesting. They have their own beliefs and perspectives about basic roles of schools. Their beliefs may draw on national reports calling for reform of education. Through such reports, as well as discussion and debates among educators, policymakers, and others, U.S. society continually refines and redefines its ideas about schools. The five roles describe the following deal with that. And I have been around long enough to see how this has been redefined over and over with new reforms. So here are those five things. Let's jump ahead here. Here are the five things. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's look at them. First, academic achievement. And you're well aware of this. That's a part of it. And what's interesting to me is that's number one, yet we so struggle with this, how we can have people leave our schools that aren't able to read. And I know there's learning disabilities and learning problems and stuff, but sometimes we get so much other clutter in there that we fail on this count, and we get so carried away with these other four that this one is the casualty, especially early on. First highlight here is to make students to take tests, sometimes teaching to tests and neglecting subjects that are not being tested, such as social studies, science, and the arts. And again, I may agree with that, but I would like to see some support here of that contention of that. And with the high stakes of testing, I don't quite understand that accusation there of why you wouldn't teach to the test if so much is riding on it. That's a taboo everybody has. Don't teach the test, teach the test. So how about this next paragraph? Media reports of students' scores on achievement tests highlights a school's ability to offer students a strong academic background. And I know that was the big idea behind standardized tests, is you could compare schools. Okay. And then down here, this one, state and national standards provide the framework for students should know and be able to do academically proficient. So there again, we have given away, it used to be local people, you, the local folks, the teachers, the board, the community side of standards, and now we have state and national standards. And this is the first mention in this text is Common Core standards. Common Core, which have been adopted by most states by the spring of 12, identify the essential required levels of knowledge and skills in English, language, arts, literacy, history, social studies, science, and technical subjects, as well as math. And they talk again, that's National Government Association, Chief of School, State College Officers. Nonetheless, this is all facilitated by the federal government and the standards. And what's interesting is a bunch of the states lessened their requirements, their standards, to down to the Common Core standards. And then, of course, the Common Core came with some really far out stretch things that most states wouldn't want anything to do with. But if you wanted to be part of this, you had to adopt the whole thing or none. You weren't allowed to alter it at all. National tests will assess students' attainment of these proficiencies. So that's what's interesting too. If this is not a federal curriculum, how can we have a national test that tests it? So in other words, I've whined to you before about this. We have given this away to the federal government, what the curriculum is and the tests. And schools have refined this a number of times. School systems' reputations and funding are depending. And that's the big one over here, that follow the money. And workforce readiness, this is another really vast one that's tried to be transmitted or prepared. And it was really driven out of all the things, a nation at risk in 1983. And I'm going to make that number two here on workforce readiness. Nation at risk. And this is what you do. You find a link to a page and you link it in here, a nation at risk, and then you also put here which president signed that into law, into national law, a nation at risk goals. Okay, so that's right there. That's number two. Okay, this is interesting too. The educational system has been blamed for students not performing at the top in international tests of knowledge and skills, and for students not developing the critical thinking and problem-solving skills needed for a growing number of jobs, and not enough students being prepared in science, technology, engineering, and math fields. And this isn't new. You've heard this before, I'm sure. And this next one's interesting. In addition, the workforce projections indicate that 62% of U.S. jobs will require post-secondary education in 2018. Interesting, one of the things you would think is that why couldn't we push more of that training down into the high schools? But obviously there's some maturity things that go on and stuff there in the expense of trying to put more there. So what should our youth know by the time they finish high school? 400 employers did this survey, and here are these four things, and I would like to make this number three. And there's four things, one, two, three, four, and they're right here. One is professional work ethic. You don't need the whole thing, just that set. Professional work ethic set, skill set. Number two, oral and written communication skill set. And I want you to know what those are, because that's what we're asking you to carry as teachers. Three, team collaboration skill set, and four, critical thinking problem solving skill set. And so if you'll bring those in, it's number three. On to here, three and four of these employers say that K-12 schools should be held responsible for preparing students with these skills. And what does held responsible mean? Interesting. Employers complain that newly hired employees, especially high school graduates, too often do not have either the basic or applied skills to participate effectively in the workplace. Business owners want graduates with vocational skills appropriate to the job, but they also want them to have the dispositions or values and attitudes such as, listen to this, punctuality and a good work ethic. Business owners and the nation's leaders also worry that not enough engineers, computers, scientists, and others, workers, the STEM, science, technology, engineering, math, are being produced in our high schools and colleges to meet the needs. So this thing about punctuality and good work ethic, and how in the world can we influence those in school? How can we prepare our students for punctuality and a good work ethic? And that will be your number four. I'm going to say punctuality and work ethic. How can we prepare? Number four, and again, clearly mark those for me. I'm very interested to see what you have. And with that, and I'm going to ask you to come back to our webpage at the bottom and respond to it also. What, here it is, what are we doing or what can we do to instill a work ethic and habit of punctuality in students in our schools? And hopefully that'll help help get us started there with that discussion. And it's really kind of a challenging thing of that if they don't have that with the work ethics. So this goes on about what are our roles, what should the rules be in our society. Down here, the framework of 21st century learning, master the basic core subject and develop global awareness, civic literacy, health literacy, financial and economic, business and entrepreneurial literacy. And so kind of a whole new world, things that you might be not aware of financial, economic literacies that are being put into curriculums. Health literacy is interesting also. Almost have information, media, technology skills to work effectively and work the workforce. And I don't think we still see enough emphasis on that, on technology skills and how important they're going to be. In this last highlighted part, workers who are competent in more than one language can make appropriate health and wellness choices and creative, innovative decisions. So also a second language. And it's interesting that if you don't think we're going to give away the care of our health also, we now have a national health care law. And even this, let me show you what this looks like here. This is the Boston Public Schools. Look at this paragraph right here in the middle. Let me read it to you. This year, the Boston Public Schools are participating in a community eligibility option. Through this federal program, federal dollars, breakfast and lunch are available to all students in all schools at no cost, regardless of family income. So Boston is the first of which will be a sweeping thing across this country, is they will have free breakfast and free lunch to all students, all funded by the federal government. So this is the control. They're going to have a federal health law, and we're going to control what you can eat, what your kids can eat, by controlling the federal, by the student hot lunch programs in our schools. And the way we're going to take you to it is we're going to make it free so everybody wants in on it. So that's how we're giving away control of our health, just like of our schools. Okay? Citizenship. Citizenship is much more than voting in elections and knowing facts about the nation's history. And it comes down here, a campaign for the civic mission of schools has identified six proven practices for civic learning. So they are classroom instruction, discussion of current events and controversial issues that includes the issues important and relevant in the lives of young people. Very interesting that we would encourage this in school. These authors are suggesting this, and they're saying it's come from this campaign of civic and missions of schools. I've never heard of that, but very interesting that we would encourage that relevant and controversial issues. And we just discussed that last week about what you thought of that. Service learning. This provides students opportunities for community service linked to formal curriculum instructions. And what's going to happen in our schools in the very near future is a required community service. We already do it to you at the college level to be admitted in the College of Education, and you're going to see this pushed down into the K-12 schools where students will be required to do community service to graduate. And I'm not sure how it's volunteer work if it's required. And then extracurricular activities that allow students to involve outside the classroom and school or community. School governance to allow students to practice democracy and simultaneous simulations of a democratic process, such as voting in the elections. So that's what it is. Classroom instruction, current events, extracurricular, school governance, simulations. I want to do this number five here. Have you ever, when you were in school, did you vote? Even though you weren't old enough to have, when there was national elections, did you vote? Will you address that here, number five? Did your school have kids voting days? Just an interesting tidbit. Now, this is interesting too. Citizenship cannot be taught in a single course. Across courses and in school activities, school officials and teachers work to develop democratic citizens who respect others, believe in human dignity, are concerned about the care of others, and fight for justice, fairness, and tolerance. Interesting. Fight for justice, fairness, and tolerance. So, all good. Students can learn that the practice of the classroom, how to be active, involved citizens. I believe there's a question on the test about saying the Pledge of Allegiance. Which of these? And I think that if saying a Pledge of Allegiance to the flag is a step in teaching citizenship. Then social development, provide opportunities for students to develop their social skills by interacting with others. And that's a big one, cross-gender, cross-age, respect others. They learn to set a rules for working appropriately with peers and teens. All schools usually do not provide a course that teaches those skills. Appropriate behavior is constantly reinforced by teachers and other professionals in the classroom and on the playground. Teachers can give students opportunities to work with other students from diverse racial, gender, language, religion, ability groups. One of the byproducts of these interactions is that students learn more about similarity than their differences. Teachers can encourage interactions across groups through cooperative learning activities in which students from different groups are placed together. And that's not new. You've had that before. You know, you've done that where you were assigned groups to do different projects. Other team projects allow students to work together who might not otherwise seek out one another. And then the next one, cultural transmission. Schools around the world are expected to transmit the culture of their nation to young people so they can both maintain it and pass it on to the next generation. Schools have often approached this task by teaching history with emphasis on important events and heroes. And then we've really changed history a lot now. For example, I was just reading that many history books, the whole World War II history is being removed and revised and stuff. And I'm guessing a lot of you couldn't spew World War II was all about. It's just not emphasized history in itself. So it's very interesting that tension here. This emphasis helps children learn the importance of patriotism and loyalty. Formal and hidden curricular reinforce the values of the national culture. Interesting. Principles, standards, and qualities of cultural endorses. And this has really gotten to be what private schools and more so homeschooling is built on, is really an exodus from this cultural transmission, that disagreeing with what's being transmitted in these ways. For example, we're going to transmit the values of a national culture, not always supported by families who want something else. And so as well as they're applauding it here, the transmission of cultural transmissions here, it also is one of the perils of our schools, because that's also how we pass on some of the idioms that we have, the ideologies that come along that you would disagree with. Oh, you think so? How about drugs, sex, and rock and roll? We don't even know about those things till we go to school. Then the culture tells us that's what's cool. And is it ever changing? Look how that cultural acceptance of music and dress and things like that have changed. And so that's all passed on in school, and the homeschool kids are unaware of that. And it's really easy to poo-poo. You say the word homeschool and you see people roll their eyes and stuff, but it's really based on this, is stopping that transmission of this culture that you disagree with. and they kind of plug it here. The dissonance between schools and families is most noticeable between students that are not European and not, not English-speaking and not Judeo-Christian. They have some common cultural disconnects here. But I think people come to this country to connect with our culture, and to run from that is always disappointing to me, that we want them to endorse their own culture. If we want to really endorse people in their home cultures, why can't we do the same for the European kids that have European descents and Judeo-Christian descent? Why can't we let them celebrate those too? But that's not really allowed. And I'm going to come over here and say this is number 6 here. And that is that homeschooling is built on countering this. Because the parents want to pass on their values and culture and not the society's. And that's where that comes from. So that's number 6. So the role of culture in schools, and I first highlight there, culture provides a blueprint of how we think, feel, and behave in society. We go on from there about these different parts of that, and that is culture is learned, shaped, and stuff. This is enculturation, which occurs when parents, grandparents, religious leaders, teachers, television shows, and our neighbors teach us the culture of acceptable norms. And that's what I'd like you to do in enculturation here. I want this a little farther. I would like all of this on page 144 of parents, grandparents, religious leaders, teachers, television shows, I would say movies, music, all those things create this enculturation. Now, of course, video games and iPods and iPads and phones. If you would list all those things that you think help enculturate our, and this is number 7, and I would like you to have quite a list of things that enculturate. Say, gives you some there, you can put those, but you tell me those other things, and maybe in your life or people you know, what has been in a cultural nation and culture nation process. Like for example, my kids play sports, people on their team, the other teammates, other families of their teammates create the enculturation. That's number 7. Not stagnant, it's dynamic, to adapting the needs of others. Okay. So what is common culture? Common culture, legal system, a democratic election, and middle-class values of American society, which served the foundation of many of our institutions and traditions, were based on Western and Northern European traditions. As new immigrants assimilated in our society over a few generations, a common culture evolved from that, reflecting the ways most middle-class families live. These commonalities make it fairly easy people to identify as American when we visit our countries. Okay, so the common culture they're contending is based on Western and Northern European cultures that were the first here and set up shop. Was middle class Protestants. For the most part, they were Protestants when they came here. Obviously, a big representation of Catholic, but for the most, the foundations of this country were built on Judeo-Christian values. Again, because they were the first here. Till recently, ancestors of early settlers dominated the country's political system, holding the highest government and corporate positions. In this role, they had great influence on institutions, policies. Civil rights struggle of the 60s and 70s opened the political corporate worlds of growing number of women and persons of color. During that period, the Civil Rights Act, Voting Rights Act, all this was passed. And what are some of the characteristics of common culture? Well, universal education. Literacy of citizens' value are great. Our job, career is important, being recognized as successful. Fun is usually a relief from work. And that is part of the culture, is fun. obviously, and everybody can understand that. It just, we all have different ideas of what that looks like. Technology is all of its forms, from cell phones to computers, and I don't use to call them cell phones anymore. They're called smartphones. Have a legal impact on our, have a great impact on our lives, especially young people. You, younger than me, anybody younger than me is young people. Achievement and success are highly valued and demonstrated by accumulation of material goods such as houses, cars, right? I don't have to tell you this. You know that. This is what success looks like. House, cars, boats, clothes, vacations. Woo! All success. Individualism and freedom are core values. Common culture in the United States. Independence, self-reliance are the major focus of individualism. Huh. Self-reliance. That's a very interesting thing. When we just passed national health care, so we can rely on the government. Focus of individual toughness and strength are admired. Freedom is a cornerstone of democracy. Okay, defined as our own destiny and success, while that not interference by others, especially by government. Interesting. Interesting. Contending that the government shouldn't interfere. And to some people, freedom means being able to live where they want, do what they want, believe what they want, improve their material conditions if they see fit. To others, freedom is more political tone, the freedom of speech, the freedom to protest, the freedom to have one's rights respected. These two concepts often take precedence over individual responsibility for community and the common good. Freedoms and individuals. And Common Core, I'm going to say this is number 8, the common culture. I'm going to say things. You list things that would determine success in the common culture. Success. So that's number 8. Then what about these cultural families? I'm going to let you glean this out of here, the culture of families. And this author contends that you, as a teacher, really need to know and identify the ethnicity of the students that you're going to teach. And it talks about here, they discuss why it's important. And then they go through a long thing here of how to get to know the cultural ethnicity of your students. And so I'm going to ask you to do that here. This will be number 9. And it's going to be how to get to know. The authenticity of your students. And that's all right here on page 145. Okay. Then the culture of values. Now, the role of culture of values, let's take a look at that. That one of the expectations is that you transmit this culture to the younger generation in schools. The authors try and frame the two sides of it here, which I believe is poorly done, but I really like you to read that, and they obviously poo-poo one. But I want you to move on to this part, a parent's choice of schools based on these values. That it could be religious schools, homeschooling, or this ethnocentric schools of curriculum and diversity. But the thing that I want to key on here a little bit is this of the hidden curriculum. And I want you to describe this. This will be our number 9, or number 10 here. The hidden curriculum. And it says here, usually support the common culture, current ideological, political, economic order of society. However, some families believe that public schools do not value their religion. Some parents do not want their children exposed to the secular values of public school, or what they perceive as inappropriate language, disrespectful behavior of students. Have you ever heard that? My kids continue to remind me how bombarded they are and how desensitized they've gotten to the very coarse and vulgar language of the school. I was a shock. My kids were brought up in a cocoon, or rather went to a small Christian private elementary school. So when they got to middle school, their ears were burning for those first few days as they listened to these 12-year-old classmates try out their new vulgar words on a regular basis. And now they both would detest that they're completely desensitized to this vulgarity that comes, that they're so used to it that they have people around them that cannot put a coherent sentence together without some vulgar in it. So what is the hidden curriculum of the schools, and why do people object to it? That's what number 10 is here. Go back here a second. There's something on the bottom here I want to point out, and that is, again, something I think flies in the face of what we do. The emphasis on the last paragraph here, the emphasis on individualism and competition prevalent in many schools is not compatible with cooperative patterns practiced by American Indians, Latinos, African Americans. I've never heard that said about African Americans, that they have not competitive. I never noticed that. These differences can lead to conflict between parents and schools, and that's we see some of that, not over this issue, over many things, but we've had many conflicts with schools and what they teach and their values that come from the culture. So that's a common thing. And but this statement here is about some of those conflicts. And if you may not believe, the schools use a democratic process which they heard the community support their things. So here's some of those topics, and I want you to talk about those: school prayer, creationism, banning of books, sex education, segregation, bullying, and discrimination are those that have all been tested in the courts. So that's what I want you to put here for number 11. Those things from page 146, right here on the very, very bottom. School prayer, creationism, banning of books, sex education, all those right here on culture of schools. Here, let me read you this paragraph too. Because parents and other groups in a community may vehemently disagree about the value of a reinforced in school, teachers should be aware of their own cultural values. Knowing your own values as well as those of families representing your school should help prevent potential conflicts. Expectations can greatly vary greatly from community to school or others. So let's go to this now. This will be, I believe, number 12. And that is, who is right? Should teachers be required to take diversity training? And that will be our number 12 here. And that again will be on the bottom of our wiki page. And this will be it. Diversity training, should teachers be required to take diversity training? And again, I ask you not to respond to this until you have read both arguments stated in the textbook. And it'll be down here on the bottom of this here. All right. Well, school culture, let's get into this a little more. And the culture of school, maybe sometimes known as the school climate. And I'm going to call this the fun part. This is the part that creates those memories that we like to think back on. I want you to read this, but some of this, you know, this is deals with mascots, cheerleaders, school color, school songs, you know, academic, you know, the reputation of schools, academic achievements, the prowess of your football team, basketball team, other sports teams, what kind of reputation your school has, you know, is it safe, is it dangerous, you know, what about the principals and the teachers, what is their culture? Talks about, you know, what if you were next to a military base where it just had 1 year students, things like that. And you know, these things are passed on from generation to generation, it seems like. And so let me take you over here. Common to the community, for the most part, both unwritten rules and norms, traditions and rituals are passed down. Experience at school and at home, and a big thing about, you know, bridging this gap between these two. Jump back here a little. Let me just say this, and disagree or agree if you want, but I went to a small school, and my kids go to huge schools, and it's just how much different those cultures are. That in any culture, there's a certain percentage of students who do not participate really in the school culture of these things. We're talking about baseball and basketball and football games and, you know, all the activities at school. But I think from teaching in a large school and, you know, having the kids in large school, a bigger percentage do not participate than in our small communities, where it's not only the hub of the school, but often the school in our smaller communities is the hub of the community, where the community comes together and embraces school culture. And I think that's where it's more likely, when and where it's more likely to be passed down from generation to generation. When you go to huge schools like my kids, the community doesn't rally around, the community doesn't pass those around. Pass those down from generation to generation. So some of those rituals and stuff are lost because of that in our bigger schools. And I don't know if it's better or worse. It's just different. It's different. The culture is different. If you're in a school with 2,500 kids in your high school or a school of 100 kids in your high school, believe me, those cultures are different. There's a lot of similarities, but there's a lot of differences also. So let's move on to school choices. Do you notice I didn't make you write anything on this one? On this one here, I didn't have to write anything. Just want you to know. So let's move on to school choices. And let me give you a kind of an overflow here. The public versus private, or charter hybrid, vouchers, magnet. By the time we're done with our discussion, you really need to have a working vocabulary of each of these. And why? Because of how our system is going to change, that for the most part, we only knew this of public schools, and now a big change into magnets, charters, virtual schools, even voucher systems here. So let's take a run at this, what these are. You know, it goes to, again, the origin of public schools. Here's one, a land ordinance of 1785 required new territories north and west of the Ohio River to set a parcel of land for a public school for each township. And so I talked about before that each township, so you had a school district for each township. And a township, I believe, was 16 miles square. And so you can imagine, even like in South Dakota, we had a lot of little school districts that had their own little country school, and that was the land ordinance passed in 1785. By the 1830s, common schools were designed in part to reduce the tension across six different groups. Again, it just gives you a little history lesson here. Here's a private school. When immigrant Roman Catholic families expressed concern about Protestant Bible teaching being taught in the common schools, the riots erupted in Philadelphia and New York City, and then when it broke out of that, the Catholic Church established a lot of their own private schools that still, more than any other, linger on today. There's more Catholic private schools than any other religious denomination. And then, of course, over time, with that, the public school curriculum became very, very secular. It said more secular. More secular. No, it is completely secular now. We've scrubbed out any thing we can with Christian or Jesus or any of those origins. It's all scrubbed, gone. You can't say the word anymore. So children and youth today have right to attend a public school. In fact, they are required, and that's really interesting here. We say it's a right or privilege, but required to be there till 16 or 18. And we know in South Dakota what the compulsory attendance laws are. Let's just check on that here, if you would. That make this number, sorry, I can't remember. This is number 13. Number 13, what is the attendance laws in South Dakota? Mark it clearly now. Show me you know it. What age you have to attend school to. Okay. Approximately 50 million students are currently enrolled in public schools. But that number is projected to increase to 52 million by 2020. So first of all, public schools. Discussion about providing parents a choice of schools that their children can attend is includes magnet schools and the use of a voucher system. So let's look at the magnet schools first. In 1960, some parents were calling for school choice, in part to counteract the racially segregated schools that existed across the country. Early alternative schools were open in Tacoma, Washington, and Boston, and Minneapolis. Many school districts continued to be pressured by citizens and ordered by courts to equalize the proportions of students from different racial groups. And really, it was a failure on a lot of levels, but they were court-ordered that if you had, you know, in your district, if, 20% of your student body in your district was African-American, then every building had to have 20% African-American. And it was a problem. Growing number of urban school districts developed special academic programs and custom designed for a diverse student body. Many of the magnet schools emphasized a theme such as performing arts and math and science and liberal arts. The faculty curriculum students generally chose the magnet school because of the interest in school. And we're going to look at this a little bit farther in our projects, but that's what magnet schools are, that now they have themes, performing arts or math or science or technology, a lot of different themes. But then, for the most part, they're very popular, and there's a waiting list. There's a raffle or a drawing to see who gets in. Very highly skilled teachers teach there, but the emphasis is one of these. And there's some downsides to it also of doing that, and that is if you got to transport them, often families from poor kids can't transport. Okay. I better go back here and say a magnet school. Let's say this. 14 is what themes. And the themes are what things are that I highlighted here. I want to take you to one website, U.S. College News, Educational News, about just the ranking of the magnet schools. And you can see here, here's the name of them and what they rank. And then here's the ratio of students to teachers, of course, which is quite low. But here's their college readiness scores based on their college prep evaluations and stuff. And look at those scores. So you can imagine who is... who they attract some very bright, talented kids. And I say they often, so what they're doing to them now is taking a percentage of kids that aren't as qualified, come from lower economic areas, things like that. Now, we don't have any magnet schools in South Dakota. Our legislature has not yet allowed that, but I'm pretty certain in the future it'll be coming. So let's look at charter schools. Charter schools are most popular option of public school systems. They have created academic institutions, nonprofit foundations, teachers, parents, for a variety of these schools, including Missouri schools, Edison schools, experimental learning schools. A number of them have come out established through a contact. Charter schools are established through a contract with either a state agency or a local school board. Usually 3 to 5 years, the contract or charter schools lays out how the school will operate in exchange for receiving public money. So they're still a public school, they're just not as bound to regulations. And here's what it said, charter schools have greater autonomy than traditional public schools and can be released from district and state regulations such as hiring licensed teachers, following teacher user contracts, and using district textbooks. However, charter schools are still held accountable for stern student learning and in most settings have a diverse student body. 2012, 42 states and the District of Columbia had passed legislation to permit and establish charter schools. Arizona, District of Columbia, Michigan, Minnesota are states that have strong charter laws. And the states, okay, as you might expect, with the majority of charter schools located in central cities, over half the students in those schools are African-American, Hispanic, and American Indian students. Charter schools are generally smaller than public schools, and over half of them are located in cities. 3 and 4 charter schools are either elementary or combined elementary schools. So it's a way to respond to alternative schools. It allows them to have smaller schools. One of the things that happens in our humongous schools is some of the kids get lost. But what's happening is becoming a bastion for racial diversity. That you don't see the European kids in there, and so that's a concern. They want that racial mix, and it's an alternative setting. They're not bound by the same laws. And again, we're going to study that a little bit, and hopefully you'll have a working vocabulary of that. And this is new on the horizon. You can imagine, just a minute here, wait a minute. I better go back and look at this. What is a charter school? Make this number 15, so you have a little note here. 15 is, what's unique about it? Why charter schools? Okay, 15. Now virtual schools, also known as cyber schools. Virtual course exists across the span of schooling from preschool through college into professional development for teachers and other workers. The number of students enrolled in online courses increased from 45,000 in 2000 to 1.8 million in 9 and 10. And 70% of them being high school students. Did you know that? 70% of all online students are high school students. And by 10-11 school year, 250,000 students enrolled full-time. We're a little, we have some of that in South Dakota, but we're a little unaware. Some of our full-time, and I know some of you did some of this in high school, and you've told me so. Increased over the previous year. At least one full-time virtual school operates in 30 states. Interesting. Most common reason for a student to participate in online school is that the course is not available in their school. That's the number one reason. It's not available in their school building. For example, students in rural areas have taken courses in foreign language and other subjects because teacher the subjects are hard to get and hard to find. So, how about advanced placement courses? Another one that comes through technology. Second most common reason to take online courses is credit recovery when students have not completed course required for graduation. Online technology will provide a valuable resource for students for being homeschooled. I would bet that's the third one. Virtual schools are generally tuition-free public charter schools. 40 states operate virtual schools or manage state-led online initiatives. Okay. So again, let's go here and tell me what virtual schools are. Voucher is a little different. Most controversial school choice option in 2011 vouchers is school vouchers. Is the simplest a voucher program issue? Okay, let me start again. Most controversial school choice option is school vouchers. Have you heard of these? Have you heard of school vouchers? It's died down a little bit, and I'll tell you why in a minute, but it's the simplest of, at its simplest, it's a voucher program issues a check or a credit that can be used by parents to send their children to a private school. Generally, the argument for vouchers is based on equalizing educational opportunities for students of color and students from low-income families whose children may be attending schools that are not meeting No Child Left Behind adequate yearly progress. This is what the National No Child Left Behind law said, is if your school was not meeting adequate yearly progress, your student could take their money and go to another school, including private schools in a lot of states. And everybody was held to that until the current administration came, and they didn't overturn No Child Left Behind. They simply gave waivers to states that they felt deserved them. So advocates often argue that vouchers are a market-driven strategy that will force public schools to compete with private schools, leading to improvement in both. That was the idea. that if these kids were leaving, these poor and minority kids were leaving the public schools to go to private schools, it would force them both to become better. And then the proponents also argued that parents of private schools pay twice the tuition for the private school and the tax dollar for the public school. Opponents worried that vouchers may encourage the most highly motivated students to abandon public schools. And that was the huge outcry, that the good kids are all going to leave and go to private schools. So, first was Wisconsin adopted the first law that allowed low-income families in Milwaukee to move their children from public to a private school with a voucher for public funds. Ohio adopted a similar voucher for Cleveland families in 96. The most expansive use of vouchers is the District of Columbia as a result of Congress enacting opportunity scholarship programs in 2004. Although Congress closed this D.C. program, Congress didn't. This president, the current president, closed it. Voucher program. It was back in President Barack Obama's budget in 2011. It didn't pass. They didn't pass a budget, and so there was. I'm not sure that's a true statement at all, but it was in the budget. If it was, I don't know. But they never passed a budget, and there's still no voucher system in Washington D.C. There was from '94 until 2009. When this president was inaugurated, and it was one of the first things he did was kill the voucher program in Washington, D.C. Most voucher programs are funded with state tax dollars. Legislation that supported early voucher programs limited them to low-income families, and that was one solution. State legislation 11 expanded the availability of vouchers to middle-class families in Indiana, Wisconsin, to families in Douglas County, Colorado. Not all voucher programs are publicly funded. Some are funded by private foundations. Typically, the amount of voucher is equivalent to what the public school would get for that student. So, if for example, in South Dakota, it's close to $6,000 tax dollars follow each, or state dollars follow each student. So, you could take that $6,000 to the private school. We don't have this in South Dakota, but if we did, that's generally what the voucher is for, is the amount of whatever this public school would get. The debates about vouchers center on the use of public dollars to support private schools. The most serious point of contention is when a voucher funded with state education money is used to pay for a child to attend a religious affiliated school, which are the main beneficiaries of these vouchers. They're generally not taking their money and going to secular schools. They're going to private schools. And so some opponents have claimed that vouchers raise constitutional questions, as you know, about church and state, separation of church and state. But the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that Cleveland's school voucher program was constitutional under the Federal Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. Now, this part's interesting too, and I want you to grab this. Research on voucher programs have found that students' academic achievement has not improved as a result of vouchers, but parents may be more satisfied because of the conditions of safety in the private schools they have chosen, and they are better than the public schools and their children who have attended. Graduation rates have been higher for students with vouchers than for those who remained in the public schools, but researchers have not been able to determine whether this difference is due to the private school or motivation of the parents who move their children to private school. So this is still teetering, a lot of fire out there, but it was just saying, couldn't the poor kids have the chance to go to these good private religious schools also? And because you're poor and live in a poor part of town, should that mean you can never go to a good private school? And that's what drove this. And you haven't heard the last of it. Teachers' unions go crazy over this. The good kids are all going to leave us, all that. And another idea behind it was to force everybody to get better. And I think that has happened. I think all these charters and magnets have forced them to get better, but I don't have any proof of that. You know how I like proof. So let me jump back here and vouchers, and you give a little explanation of vouchers. Number 17. Private. They've been an integral part since the beginning. Students from all racial, religious, economic, and language backgrounds. Some are progressive and innovative. Some are conservative and traditional. They are large and small, day and boarding, single-sex, co-educational. They include Montessori, special ed, vocational, technical, alternative, preschools. All are private. They range from elite secondary schools, mainly in the Northeast, to alternative schools for high school dropouts, or faith-supported schools, or schools that are operated for profit. The majority our private schools are at the elementary level, with only 8% of the secondary level. More students are enrolled in private kindergartens than any other grade level. Private schools are more likely to be located in cities than in suburbs than in rural areas. Okay, so first of all, a parochial school. 4 in 5 private schools attend a school supported by a religious group. The culture of parochial school may have a positive impact on student achievement. Some researchers have found that students at religious schools, especially African American and Hispanics, perform better on standardized tests than their public school peers. Boy, I bet it's got to be hard to put that down. And that's the thing. And one of the things we're never going to attribute it to is the religious aspect. We're going to make a case here that it's because it's private, but people of faith would say the reason is also it's a school of faith. Many religious groups sponsor schools, including Amish, Muslim, Jews, Quakers, Catholics, and many, many Protestant groups. And here they are, and of course the biggest is the Roman Catholic. And this is the fastest growing one, is the non-sectarian, meaning it's a religious private school, it's just not affiliated with any of the religions. Okay. Although enrollment in Roman Catholics is higher than in other private schools, it decreased from 45% total enrollment to private schools in this. Okay, so what about parochial schools? Tell me a little bit about these. This is number 18. And first of all, what it is. What is a parochial school? And what groups serve it? It gave you a list. The text gives you a list of who all have parochial schools. And do they have higher achievement? Absolutely. Is it because they're private? Maybe. Can it have anything to do with their faith-based schools? The text doesn't address that. And I suppose they wouldn't dare. How about a single-sex education? Sounds a little weird, but... Most single-sex schools and colleges today are private and sure of going helping their students. I have not heard of a public school that's single-sex. That just wouldn't fly, even though they have some pretty solid research learning is improved. Test scores are better out of those, but it's not politically correct. Schools and colleges today are private. Academic achievement, leadership skills by building their unique learning styles and cultural experience. Schools or academies in some urban areas have been established for young African men with the goal of improving their opportunities for enrolling in being successful in college life. All girls and all boys schools are more likely to be at the secondary level than any others. In fact, 15% and 13% of all private secondary schools are all boys or all girls respectively. Likely to be in the Northeast. So not 13 to 15 of all schools, of all private schools, are same-sex schools. See, I read one time that the research shows that that's pretty well, but they bury think of a public school that was all one sex, it just wouldn't fly, but they're finding that the learning is better, the results are better. What I want you to put here for number 19 is just private. Just private, but better. I know. You don't want to go to a same-sex school either, but don't argue with the facts that the learning is better. What about homeschooling? Requires no public support. Instead, children learn from home from their parents, serving as a teacher. And an estimated 2 million, it's funny they can estimate, it's funny they don't know that should be a stat. Being schooled at home, representing, can you get this? A fast escalating number, 3.9% of kids, K-12 kids, are homeschooled. That's up from 1.7 in 99. So it's a growing number. Although the educational program for 84% of homeschool students is provided totally at home. Others attend school for 9 to 20 hours a week. Homeschool students sometimes participate in sports and extracurricular activities, local public school. I don't think we allow this in South Dakota. I know it's been much controversy and it's been changed a number of times, but can you be homeschooled and come and play on the team? Is a big point of contention. Teaching a homeschool student requires parents to know the subjects they are teaching, organize each day's instruction, facilitate their learning. One of the advantages of well potential weakness is that most days subjects are taught are self-determined. This can work in favor of students' interests due to gaps in their education. Why do students choose to parents choose to homeschool children? In a national survey of parents, three reasons were prominent. One in three parents indicated they wanted to provide religious or moral instruction. Not available in school, not allowed in school. One in five parents was concerned about the school environment. And 17% of parents were dissatisfied with the academic instruction. So, that's what you get here. Number 20 is why. Three reasons. Okay. The evidence is clear that homeschooling is a success for many students. Studies have found that homeschool students score 15 to 30 percentile points above the public school peers. And that's the part that nobody talks about. That's the part where they win. They are 15 to 30 percentile points above the rest on the ACT and SAT scores. Or all scores on their standardized academic tests. Homeschool, high school students score an average ACT well above that. So there. Our research studies are not yet able to determine whether the higher achievement to these students is due to homeschooling. They may have scored at the same level if they attended public schools. Get that? They may have attended. Maybe they would have. I don't know. That's a big gap, though. That's a big gap to say it's random. Then what about innovative options? You are beginning to see teaching career, a very exciting time in which teaching and learning may break out of the classroom mode and exist in most schools over the past century. Seat time requirements. Many are eliminating seat time, meaning how many days you have to attend. And to change the school funding, textbook requirements, teacher evaluation requirements, you are not quite likely to teach one or more courses electronically, especially because states are beginning to require online learning before graduation. And that's what at DSU, I don't think you should be able to graduate from DSU unless you've taken an online course. You may be teaching and coaching students who you seldom or never see. You may live in a different state or possibly a different country. I have had people in my online courses that were in different countries. They were citizens, but they were in a station for other reasons or they were residing in other countries. Advocates for these and other innovative options argue that they will serve students more effectively in current teaching strategies and school structures. So online and hybrid, that's innovative options. I'll just write other countries here. Countries. Then what's an online hybrid? Well, could be synchronous or asynchronous, and I teach all synchronous courses. Synchronous meaning different time, different place. Which occurs over there with synchronous and non-synchronous instruction. Becoming common in P-12 settings. Graduates, 38% of high school students and 19% of middle school students take online courses. Although 78% of these students access online courses from home, most acquire those at school. Hybrid or blended programs combine online work with face-to-face. And you've heard that term, I'm sure. The hybrid approach is the most common at this time. But, full-time online programs and virtual schools are growing each year. So you tell me what these are. Number 21, what is online and hybrid learning? So what is the personalization technology allowing education to be customized for each student? Tasks have been very difficult in classrooms for 30 students. allowing students to work at their own pace in a different time at these Khan Academies. The website includes this, so you give me a little description of this. It's number 22. How did you personalize it? Okay, let's look at the different levels in school. And this you're more familiar with. This will be a nice review for you. And so I'm not going to peddle with this too much. I'm just going to do an overview and then ask you to carry it from here. First, there's the early childhood look of the Head Start with like Montessori, High Scope, Reggio Emilia thing. And then elementary schools, just looping and resource teachers. Make sure you get that. And middle level, interdisciplinary team teaching, block scheduling, traditional high schools. So what I'm going to do is break these down and ask you to give a little report on each one. This is number 22, I believe, and I'll take you over to this page, and this is number 23. Rather than me go through and read this all to you tell you about this, I'm going to let you read this, and I'm going to implore you to read this. It's a pretty good read on each of these things here. So number 22 and 23, right there, just giving a little report on each of those. For example, on the middle level, I want you to divide a little bit between junior high and middle school and what that was about. See if you can discern that from there in there. Okay, so let me just fly over here if I could. This early childhood stuff here, and my book's a little slow today. This is an interesting read about what's happened to play, how we've got the kids so scheduled that they don't get to play anymore. And this about elementary schools and the size. Here's the resource teacher and the looping that I want you to do. But again, I implore you to read the whole thing. Here it talks, each one of these levels talks about the origin of it at the beginning and then talks about why they did what they did. And then we get into high schools. Born in 1821. Here in the middle, I highlight fewer students are completing high school within 4 years, with more than 50% of African Americans, Hispanic male students dropping out of school. Only 3 in 5 students with disabilities earn a regular school diploma, which increased in the past 15 years. And they don't talk about Native Americans here, but their rate is higher for that of not completing. And then, of course, that how are these kids prepared for post-secondary? We just talked about earlier in the chapter that 62% of the jobs will need post-secondary training, and it's not... It's not addressed. If you have more than 50% dropping out, you know, how are they going to be able to, right here, limit their future job opportunities with not even finishing high school? So traditionally, secondary school is generally larger. 12% of them are in need of improvement, which I think that's a good number. If there's only 12% and No Child Left Behind were identified as needs improvement, I thought that was a good number, because only 58% of secondary schools offer at least one advanced placement course. A number of students do not have access to higher level courses. And that's where the technology can really alter that. If only 58% offer at least one advanced. This is interesting here. High schools today are being attacked as wastelands for young people. The curriculum and structure appear to have changed little over the 50 years. I don't think that's true. They're contemned for not integrating technology, critical thinking, and problem solving in the curriculum. Too many graduates are not proficient in math and reading and are not competitive on international tests with peers in Canada, Japan, and South Korea. As a result, governors and business organizations have established committees to reform schools. And that's what this up here was. I was back a page where it talked about how many were not proficient. Oh, here it is. Here, 12th grade students at the proficient level or above by race and ethnicity. In South Dakota, we're higher than this. And each year, schools will have a report card of how many are proficient stuff. But you're seeing, okay, these dang Asians kind of blow the thing apart all the time because they don't fit the minority pattern narrative we like to tell. Students in approximately 2,000 of the lowest performing high schools account for the highest dropout rates. So go figure, and you would have known that too, that The poorer the school is, the more likely the dropout rate is. In these schools, 60% or less of the freshman class finish high school. So the lowest 2,000, I'm going to highlight this, and you can put this in your notes. The lowest 2,000 performing schools account for the highest dropout rate, as many as 60% dropout. Okay. Many of the dropouts are lost in the ninth grade as students learn that they have not been prepared for the academic work of high school. As many as 40% of these ninth graders repeat the ninth grade. Only 10 to 15% of these repeaters end up graduating. Low attendance rates and failing grades in middle school have been found to be predictors of dropping out. African Americans and American Indian and Hispanic students are being hurt the most by these conditions, at 6 times more likely than white students to attend these low-performing schools. Why? Because often they're in low-income areas is why the minority kids tend to be in there most. And what is hard, and this is what you'll arrive at if you haven't already, is the education is still the silver bullet to get out of that lifestyle. But what happens is we're getting into the 10th and 11th generation now. Well, and some of the Native Americans, you know, more than that, goes back hundreds of years of this, from some of the early treaties of, taking care of them perpetuity-wise, of providing for their needs. So, in high school reform, among the most reforms is the creation of small high schools to promote stronger relationships. And we're seeing some of that now in Sioux Falls, where they're trying to create schools within the schools. These small schools were sometimes standalone schools, and other times schools within larger schools. Both the development of small high schools and research about small schools have been supported by private funding such as Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Mixed results about the effectiveness of this effort. One of the success stories has been New York City, where 23 large failing high schools were replaced by 216 small high schools. They were able to reduce the risk of dropping out. The ninth graders increased graduation rates. Other innovations projections are integrating technology and hands-on learning throughout the high school curriculum. One example, acclaimed High Tech High, which was operating 11 charter schools, diverse student bodies in San Diego, Chula Vista, and San Marcos. They integrated technical and academic education and hands-on approach. So you're seeing more of that different approach to it. Another innovative approach, a new tech network was founded in Napa, California. Faculty at 86 public high schools in 16 states used a project-based approach to engage students. Students actively engaged in technology as a primary tool of learning process. And you've heard of that too. So there's those, and just stop now and go ahead and do those. Sense of place, like rural communities, 2,500 residents or less, long travel distance to school structure is less stratified, less diversity, teacher shortages, schools are prized by communities, and that's what I was talking about earlier. The school is the hub of the community. Everything that happens in the community surrounds what's going on at school, and school often becomes a community center. If you need community events, they're held in school buildings also. Then more suburban, half the population lives in suburbs, and more diversity there, better funding for schools, more of elite families or families make more money there, and of course there are larger enrollments. And then urban, they're more rich in educational and entertainment resources, diverse populations, less experienced teachers, highly centralized, authoritative, and bureaucrats there. Let me go back to the text and have a look at it. I won't have you do any of this, but you know this about our rural. And all I can say is please read this. There's questions on the tests about this area. Like high-tech companies have found that suburb ideal for research and development of software electronics. Families may move from cities to the suburbs and ensure their children receive a better education. Although overall racial and ethnic diversity of suburban schools districts has increased, diversity has been limited. Okay, then urban communities, and again, you've seen those looks. Also, we have those around here. Oh, this is a chart how diverse the schools are. If they looked at the top 100 high schools, or not top, the largest 100 high schools, and what percentage of this, see the black community, Hispanic, and white community, less of those, mostly Hispanic in those. This is free or reduced lunches. These are kids that have disabilities and IEPs. So more than half the kids get free or reduced lunches in the 100 biggest. Cultural capital, there's a question on the test about cultural capital. Okay, chapter 6.